Let me read from Philippians chapter 2, well-known verses that describe the humility and the exaltation of Christ. Do nothing from selfishness or conceit, but in humility count others better than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which you have in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God something to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on the cross. Therefore God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Well, let's praise our God and Saviour Jesus by singing the hymn number 165.
Thank you.
Let's bow in prayer. God our Father, we praise you that you have raised your Son from the dead and exalted him to that highest place and given him the name which is above all names, that all might worship and serve him. We thank you that he sits at your right hand, reigning, but he's also there as our great high priest, who offered himself as a sacrifice for sin. And that sacrifice has been accepted in the place of all our wrongdoings. And so we thank you that there is atonement and reconciliation and salvation and forgiveness for all who put their trust in him. God our Father, even as we praise you for your Son and his humble service that took him all the way to the cross, we also need to confess that we fail, we fall down, we don't always live up to our profession of faith. We identify with Jesus Christ, and yet so often we act so differently than he did. We're not always the servants of all. And so, God our Father, we confess these things and we thank you again for that free and full forgiveness made possible through Jesus, your dear Son. Father, we pray that you would enable us to put everything in our lives under the Lordship of Jesus, that we might not only profess him as Saviour and Lord, but live in such a way that it's obvious to anyone who looks at us, who we belong to, who we are serving, and whose spirit is at work in our lives. And so continue to change us and enable us to submit ourselves wholly to you, our thought life, how we speak, how we treat others, our attitudes, what we're living for. May we bring honour to your Son Jesus, the one who deserves all honour and praise, and in whose name we pray. Amen. Keith will bring to us the announcements. Was it something I said? No. No. He's promised me he is going to come and give us the announcements. Yeah.
I sort of cut down the QRM. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our service this morning. Our numbers are down a little bit, but I think mainly because the Rutherford family have a family gathering today and they're not with us, and also, unfortunately, unless you haven't heard, Will had an accident 2 weeks ago, and they eventually did a CT scan last Thursday, and they diagnosed it as a fractured pelvis, unfortunately, so which means that he's out for 8 weeks recovering, and he's now had 2 weeks, so he's got 6 weeks to go. So we'll keep Will in our prayers. Also on the welcoming, I'd like to welcome our guest preacher this morning, and that's he's not unknown to us because he's here quite frequently, the Reverend Dr. Greg Goswell, and also we welcome Mignon as well, as we'll be hearing from her later, I hope. So I don't think there's any other news there. So, and regarding the bread beers, they went to that sunny place called Sydney. But apparently, I had an email from them when they were approaching Sydney, and they said, "We are now approaching soaking Sydney." And I got another email yesterday, and they said, "The rain seems to be attaching themselves to them." And she said, "The weather is horrible." So much for holidays, rest and recuperation, and reunion with the family. Next Wednesday would normally be our sweet hour of prayer, but unfortunately, with Graham away, Will indisposed, and I've got a medical appointment that afternoon, so we'll have to defer it until the following week. So sorry about that, but by the same token, those that do pray, that in a covenant way during the lockdown, feel free to pray for our congregation and our country. Next Sunday, Graham will be returning, we hope, as he gets through the floodwaters, and then we'll be celebrating the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. Now, there's another item. Ken, Ken Margot, as you have realised, he's during Graham's absence, he's been doing the standing in for doing the streaming for the service, and he's also set up the website that we have on Facebook. He's also loaded material onto our website, and including a transfer of the Reverend Dr. Peter Locke's sermons. They've been transferred across, and he manages the website. Now, unfortunately, Ken also manages a website for another church, and he's finding the two of them a little bit much, and he'll and although we've appreciated his friendship and fellowship, he's going to move across to the other church. We have remember last week I requested any volunteers, and two came forward, and that is Ian and Sonia Rutherford. So we'll be anticipating that they'll be managing the website after Ken finishes in 2 or 3 weeks' time, Ken? Right. So we've been very appreciative of Ken, and we've appreciated his friendship and fellowship, particularly when he was studying for his, or doing the thesis for his doctorate, which is now been completed. So, Ken, would you mind coming forward? This is a surprise to Ken, I think.
Ken, speak, Your Honor.
On behalf of the church, I'd like to thank you for your friendship, your fellowship, and also your contribution to the church, and we'd like you to accept a gift card.
Thank you very much. Bless you all.
So,
thank you very much.
Good, Ken. So, with that, you'll now be waited upon for your freewill offering.
God, our Father, we thank you that you accept our gifts of money and the use of our talents in your kingdom work. Lord, thank you that for all who serve within the life of our church and ways in which we support gospel work, not only here, but in other places too. Lord, we pray that you would grow your kingdom in the hearts and lives of men and women, boys and girls, as they submit themselves to Jesus, and we pray in his name. Amen. Well, it is good to be back with you. We're still in disguise, but I think I can recognise you all. So it's good to have you. And yes, thank you, Ken, for your work with all that technology. I'm glad I wasn't asked to run the website, or it would definitely be on the blink. So, so thank you for those who step forward and meet those kind of needs. It's great. Let's hear from God's word, and Suzanne is going to read in Amos chapter 3.
The reading is from Amos chapter 3, verses 1 to 8. Witnesses summoned against Israel. Hear this word, people of Israel, the word the Lord has spoken against you, against the whole family I brought up out of Egypt. You only have I chosen of all the families of the earth. Therefore I will punish you for all your sins. Do two walk together unless they have agreed to do so? Does a lion roar in the thicket when it has no prey? Does it growl in its den when it has caught nothing? Does a bird swoop down to a trap on the ground when no bait is there? Does a trap spring up from the ground if it has not caught anything? When a trumpet sounds in a city, do not the people tremble? When disaster comes to a city, has not the Lord caused it? Surely the sovereign Lord does nothing without revealing his plan to his servants, the prophets. The lion has roared. Who will not fear? The sovereign Lord has spoken. Who can but prophesy? This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
So there we have the prophet Amos with his stern and threatening message to Israel. And likening God's message through Amos to the roaring of a lion. That's the way the prophets speak. And we remember when we turn to the New Testament that the equivalent of the Old Testament prophets in the New Testament are the apostles, aren't they? The apostles are the prophets of the New Testament. And like the Old Testament prophets, they know stuff. They know things that other people don't know because God is speaking through the prophets and the apostles. And they can talk directly and sternly at times, and sometimes they've got to rebuke God's people like the Old Testament prophets had to. And so when we sometimes catch ourselves thinking, you know, the people of Israel, why did they never listen to the prophets, you know? Don't get caught out, you know, kind of, do we always perfectly listen to what the New Testament prophets, the apostles, are telling us in the New Testament, in their writings? So, yes, we're in the same kind of position, aren't we? So we need to take seriously, listen very carefully, and do what God is telling us through his apostles in the New Testament as well. Let's bow in prayer. Great God, our Father, we Thank you that we find in your Son Jesus the perfect example of all that we should be. He was the man for others, the friend of sinners. His great concern were the needs and interests of those around him. He thought about others, and it was that loving self-giving that took him all the way to the cross, where he made himself our Saviour. And so we thank you for Jesus, the greatest example of all, and yet also more than an example, the one who did what no one else is in a position to do. Being the sinless Son of God, he took our sin and punishment upon himself. The one who can help us in the way that no one else can, because he took our place and made himself our substitute and paid our debt, so that through faith in his name we may know forgiveness and eternal life. Thank you for our Saviour Jesus. And thank you that he's the risen Lord Jesus, seated at your right hand, and soon he will return to complete his work. And so this whole world will become his kingdom and will enjoy the new heavens and the new earth in which righteousness dwells. Yes, God, our Father, we pray that you would continue your work in this world and also your work in our hearts and lives, that we might become more and more like Jesus. And Lord, we thank you for those who set an example for us to follow. We think even of our Sovereign Lady, Queen Elizabeth. We thank you for her life of service. Lord, we remember how recently she urged her subjects to think about others. And so thank you for the way in which she has served the Commonwealth and this nation. Please uphold her, we pray. And Lord, we pray for our political leaders who serve under her. Lord, we pray that you would give us leaders who promote community, unity, and cohesion. Lord, in these troubled times, help all our leaders, state and federal, whatever their political persuasion, to be promoting the welfare of all. Not to be divisive for political ends, but to seek the good of the nation as a whole. And Lord, when there's been unrest in our streets, Lord, we pray that you would bring calm. We pray for those who influence public opinion in various ways, overt and hidden. Lord, we pray that all would seek the good of our nation. We pray for leaders within our church. Lord, enable our ministers and elders and others who lead not to be self-serving, but indeed to be servants of Christ and examples of humble service. Lord, we pray for our health workers, our hospital staff under strain at this time. Lord, we pray for those who are sick or also have experienced accidents, or are simply bearing the aches and pains that advanced age can bring. Lord, may they know your nearness and that help which comes from above. Lord, we pray for all who are vulnerable in our society. We think of the Aboriginal communities with this concern over COVID. Please protect those communities, and we pray for Aboriginal leaders and others who assist them. Lord, we pray for big issues that we face as a nation, even as a world, with climate change and wild weather events. We thank you that you are the Creator God and you're the God of providence, and that you use people, both those who acknowledge you and those who don't, to serve your good purposes in this world. Father, we thank you that when things seem out of control, they never are, but all things are in your sovereign hands, and those are hands of love and infinite wisdom too. And so, Father, keep us and keep all your people calm and trusting and serving in our daily lives as you give opportunities. Lord, please be with us this coming week. Lord, in these last couple of difficult years, you've been seeking to remind us of the things that matter, things of eternity, things of the faith. Yes, our families, looking out for our neighbours, caring for others. Lord, help us to serve all for our Saviour's sake. And we pray this, also praying the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Mignon will now bring us our reading from the first letter of Paul to Timothy. Thank you.
So the reading is from the first letter of Paul to Timothy, beginning in chapter 1 and reading from verses 1 to 11. So 1 Timothy chapter 1, beginning at verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by command of God our Saviour and of Christ Jesus our hope, to Timothy, my true child in the faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. As I urged you when I was going to Macedonia, remain at Ephesus, that you may charge certain persons not to teach any different doctrine, nor to occupy themselves with myths and endless genealogies which promote speculations rather than the divine training that is in faith. Whereas the aim of our charge is love, that issues from a pure heart and a good conscience and sincere faith. Certain persons, by swerving from these, have wandered away into vain discussion, desiring to be teachers of the law, without understanding either what they are saying or the things about which they make assertions. Now we know that the law is good, if anyone uses it lawfully, understanding this, that the law is not laid down for the just, but for the lawless and disobedient, for the ungodly and sinners, for the unholy and profane, for murderers of fathers and murderers of mothers, for manslayers, immoral persons, sodomites, kidnappers, liars, perjurers, and whatever else is contrary to sound doctrine, in accordance with the glorious gospel of the blessed God with which I have been entrusted.
Well, let's sing another hymn that reminds us of the kind of responses that we should be making to his word. It's the hymn number 338, Lord, speak to me that I may speak, 338. Let's pray. Yes, God our Father, we ask that you would help us as we look at your word. Even the Apostle Peter has said that there are some things in the writings of the Apostle Paul that are hard to understand. So give us understanding. And more than that, as we understand, give us grace to listen, to obey, to put these things into action. And we pray this through Jesus. Amen. Well, I'm not sure if you're one of these people who likes getting letters. Maybe it doesn't matter anymore. We don't get any, do we? We may as well kind of, you know, take the letterbox off the front fence, haven't we? Like the only thing I ever find there are kind of bills or something like that. So, but yes, some of us maybe still get letters. Some of us are writing letters, I hope. But if we're Christian people, of course, we've always got mail, haven't we? The letters written to us by the Apostle Paul. So when all else fails, here are some letters. And I want us to look just at the opening words, the opening couple of verses, really, of this letter of Paul to Timothy. And let's take it as a letter to us, because indeed it is and it's meant to be. What does Timothy say? What does Paul say? To Timothy, my true child in the faith. So here's a letter to a close companion, a dear friend, a co-worker. Paul knows Timothy well. Timothy knows Paul well. A personal letter. But if it is that, if it's a letter from Paul to his beloved child in the faith, Timothy, why does the letter in fact open so formally and with Paul reiterating his very high position of authority in the church? Notice the opening words of this letter to Timothy. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by command of God our Saviour and of Christ Jesus our hope. Timothy really needed to be reminded that Paul was an apostle and had this exalted position of authority given to him by God and Jesus Christ. Hardly. And so even though, yes, this is classified as one of Paul's letters to an individual, Timothy, it's plain enough that it's, yes, it is that, but it's more than that. It's written to Timothy, but we can't say it's written only to Timothy. But it does have this kind of very formal kind of opening, which is typical of Paul's letters to churches. And almost from random, the opening words of Paul's letter to the Colossians, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God. See, that's the kind of way in which Paul writes when he's writing to a church. And so that's what we need to realise here. Yes, he's writing to Timothy, but he's writing to churches through Timothy. And everything that Paul says in this letter to Timothy, the church needs to also read and take notice of, because these are the things that Timothy is going to implement in the churches. And so it is a little bit more complicated, isn't it? It's not simply a letter to an individual. And indeed, the way in which the letter closes, his final remarks, his farewells, grace be with you. And we can't tell in English, but we can tell in Greek, that's you plural. So he really is writing not only to Timothy, but he's writing to the church and churches that Timothy is responsible to. And he's writing in this letter to Timothy about things that concern church life. And maybe particularly after we've read through chapters 2 and chapter 3, where Paul has said this is how men should behave in the church and this is how women should behave, and here are some instructions for the elders and others for the deacons. And that's why at the end of chapter 3, or near the end, verse 15, now Timothy knows how people should behave in the household of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and bulwark of the truth. So obviously these instructions are for church life generally. And so what we really have here is Paul speaking to churches through Timothy and their instructions for churches which are going to be implemented or encouraged by Timothy. So there really is not this kind of big difference that we sometimes draw between the letters of Paul to churches and his several letters to individuals. Now, really, this is typical of the Bible generally, and we need to remind ourselves in this individualistic age in which we live that the Bible really has a group focus, not so much an individual focus. Now, of course, yes, we as individuals are reading the Bible, and we need to, and we should. And when ministers preach, they're preaching to individuals, but they are also preaching to the church as a body corporate. And the application of Scripture is not just, it includes, but not just what we do as individuals as we kind of take seriously what we hear in the Bible, but it's meant to shape us as a body of people, the people of God gathered. And so there is in the Bible this focus on God's people as a group. And so the application is always a response of us as individuals, but also our response as a group of God's people. Well, what parts of the Bible were written to individuals as opposed to groups? I think we've got to say that there's not a single book in the Old Testament that was written to an individual. The whole of the Old Testament, all the books, are addressed to a group or groups. What does Moses say in the book of Deuteronomy? Hear, O Israel. Chapter 6, verse 4, one of the most famous passages in Deuteronomy, but hear, O Israel. And we read from Amos chapter 3, and that could be taken as a representative example of the diction of the Old Testament prophets. What does Amos say? I quote, hear this word the Lord has spoken against you, O people of Israel, against the whole family that I have brought up from Egypt. All of the Old Testament is addressed to groups, the people of God, and particularly the people of Israel. When we turn to the New Testament, how do we go here? Well, Luke Acts was written to Theophilus, but who was this man Theophilus? Probably a high-ranking Roman who was a believer that wanted more clarity about the faith. But really, Theophilus is kind of like the patron of Luke's writing. It's kind of dedicated to Theophilus, so to speak, but it can't be simply just for him, because Luke Acts together makes up almost a quarter of the New Testament. That cannot all have been written just for one person. Yes, Luke Acts. Then we have Paul's letters to Timothy, Titus, Philemon, but we've already seen in the case of Timothy, he's really writing to the church through Timothy. And the letter to Philemon also says, it's to Philemon, I quote, and to the church that meets in your house. And so Paul writing these letters, he expects the churches to be kind of reading the letter over the shoulder, so to speak, of these individuals, Timothy and Titus, that he's writing to. Another letter to an individual, maybe the third letter of John, but that does end with the words, again, I quote, greet the friends there in my name. So a way of talking about the Christian community, the letter is going to. And so these friends, and I gather this is where, you know, the Society of Friends, the Quakers, get their name from, they presumably were allowed to read this letter of 3 John as well. Look, at the very most, we can maybe squeeze 7 books out of 66 written to individuals. But even in that case, I think we'd have to say there's no book in the Bible really written only to an individual. And so there's this group focus. Now, of course, the individual is not forgotten, but we need to remember if we're a Christian, then we are part of a group. We are a member of a body. This body, the church. Of course, in the Christian faith, the individual is not slighted or forgotten. I hope you've read the Father Brown books, these kind of detective, little detective stories by C.K. Chesterton, like there's some kind of version on TV, isn't it? But the books are fabulous. And in one of those stories, Chesterton, through Father Brown, says, I quote, "It's the hardest thing in theology to believe, namely that God cares about the individual." He cares about individual human beings, the hardest thing in theology to believe. Because that's not our experience in life, is it? Someone moves away, someone dies, life goes on. It shouldn't, but it does. You know, how significant is the individual in life generally? But the Bible tells us that we as individuals are incredibly important to God. So we're not slighting the individual. Please don't take anything I say as implying that your individuality, your individual response to God, your immortal soul, I'm not saying or implying that's not absolutely important to God. But let's also remember that we're members of a group. And the Bible doesn't see any great merit in individualistic Christianity. You know, I'll do it my way. I don't care what other people think or doing, but this is what I think I'm doing. That kind of attitude, the Bible doesn't encourage. Part of being a Christian, committed to Christ, but also committed to the people of Christ. And so there is a church and there's membership of a church, and we should not sit loose on church life. And part of being a Christian is also abiding by church decisions when we don't always in every way absolutely agree with what the leaders of the church might decide about this, that, or the other thing. So part of being a Christian, submitting to Christ, but also in many ways submitting to our brothers and sisters in Christ. So the individual matters, but also we're part of a group. And so this is more than a personal letter. And Paul, in writing these things, is exercising more than just personal authority. The apostle's authority is not just the power of a strong personality. Let's not believe that for a moment. But behind the apostle Paul stands Jesus Christ. Notice what Paul says. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the command of God our Saviour and Jesus Christ our hope. He's an apostle. He's the designated, appointed spokesperson for Jesus Christ. And so what Paul says and what Paul writes is what Jesus, through Paul, is telling his church. And so if the apostles are like the New Testament prophets, the equivalent of the Old Testament prophets, just like Amos and the other prophets said, thus says the Lord, Paul, in effect, and every time he writes, he's saying, thus says Jesus. So he's in the same authoritative position as the Old Testament prophets. And all that he's writing and doing, what does he say? It's by the command of God our Saviour and of Christ Jesus, our hope. And so it's a royal command performance. That's what the Apostle Paul is claiming, isn't he? And twice in this letter, he describes God as a king. And who is his chief minister? Who is the divine king's prime minister? The Apostle Paul is claiming that kind of position of authority here. And so Paul writes under orders, and nothing the Apostle Paul says or teaches can we simply say, oh, that's what Paul says. That's not a response we're able to make, because he's speaking to us on behalf of God our Saviour and Christ Jesus our hope. So there's an authority structure, you see, in the church. God, the apostles, and then the rest of us. There's an authority structure. And matters in church life are decided by quotation, quoting the Bible. How do we decide stuff in the church? Should we do this or not do that? What do Christians believe? How should Christians behave? What's a Christian response to this issue? We quote a Bible verse. I trust in context. Things in church life are decided by quotation, quoting Bible verses. Remember what Jesus, in the Gospels we read, Jesus said, haven't you read this scripture, the stone that the builders rejected? There's Jesus quoting Psalm 118. That decides it. End of the issue. Jesus shows, quoting Bible verses, that's how we work out what's right or wrong and how we should live. Paul, quoting Jesus, Acts chapter 20, remembering the words of the Lord Jesus, that the Lord Jesus himself said, it's more blessed to give than to receive. That settles it. That decides the matter. Paul, quoting Jesus, we have the same quotation of Jesus in Luke's gospel. Things are decided in church life by quoting Bible verses. So we're not a society, you see, of free thinkers. Christian people, we're not a gathering of rugged individualists, though we're allowed to have our individuality. We're not a chapter of the local council for civil liberties. See, in the world, people can say things, I can think what I like. I can do what I like as long as I don't hurt anybody else. So people can talk that way out there. But that's not how Christians are allowed to talk or behave in the life of the church. The individual matters. We don't believe in squashing the individual or trying to destroy the individuality, individual personality and so forth. But there's also the group, and there's church life. And here the Apostle Paul, Jesus, through the Apostle Paul, shows us how church life is meant to be shaped. The individual and the church. Well, do we listen to the Apostle? Or do we ever catch ourselves saying or thinking, oh, that's Paul? Like, I've heard people talk that way. Not thinking about present company, but people do, about different issues where people don't like some of the things the Apostle Paul says. Oh, that's only Paul. Now, that's Paul teaching the gospel that he received from Jesus Christ himself. In many ways, if we don't accept Paul, we're in great danger of not just losing Paul, but losing the gospel as well. Because what does he say? He says here, he's the apostle of Christ Jesus by the command of God, our Saviour. We can very quickly become very unclear about the way of salvation if we don't listen to the Apostle Paul. The 16th century Reformation, it was a rediscovery of the gospel because it was a rediscovery of the teaching of the Apostle Paul. Yes. That's why the church changed. They always had the writings of the Apostle Paul. But now Luther, Calvin, other people, hey, do you notice what Paul says? It was a rediscovery of Paul. And it was also a rediscovery of the gospel. And hence the church life was transformed. So the importance of the Apostle Paul, because, and of the apostles generally, because God was speaking through his apostles. Now, I can remember times in church life. I've lived long enough. I can remember when the Apostle Paul wasn't the flavour of the month in the church. I can remember growing up in the Presbyterian Church of Australia, I hasten to add. And what did you get in sermons where you never heard Paul being preached? Social comment, bit of pop psychology, little stories about Jesus. Was it any wonder when I was growing up, when I was young, you didn't hear about Christian conversion, you didn't hear about people becoming Christians, because the church was pretty big, the church building was pretty full and it was a big building, but you didn't hear about the gospel or conversion and those kind of things, because you didn't tend to hear about the Apostle Paul. I trust in our church life, Paul will never be out of favour again. Because there does seem to be some kind of correlation. Get rid of Paul and you tend to get rid of the gospel as well. I remember a minister friend of mine who was accused of always preaching Paul. That was his problem. Well, I think he was falsely accused. I believe that what he was doing, because he was an older minister, he wasn't one of these young, you know, kind of hot shots, you know, who anything's possible, but he was an experienced older minister who I think his crime was that he preached the gospel from all different parts of the Bible, but because he was preaching the gospel, it did kind of sound a bit like Paul, because there's this link up, you see. Really, that complaint was a backhanded compliment. Really, the person is, you know, who complained that he's always preaching at Paul was really saying, hey, this minister really knows his job. He's regularly preaching the gospel and making it very clear to us. It was a backhanded compliment. This link up between Paul and the gospel. Notice here he says, by the command of God, our Saviour. How can God be our Saviour? How did that take place? Paul will explain in this letter, a bit further down in this same chapter, verse 15, that Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. How is God the Father our Saviour? By sending Jesus to die for sinners. See, the apostle is going to be explaining the gospel in this letter to the church through Paul. The clearest gospel thinking and teaching in the Bible comes from the Apostle Paul. And notice here in the first verse how God, our Saviour, and Jesus Christ, they go together, and you can't have one without the other. In the second verse, grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. We can't have God as our Father unless we've got Jesus Christ as our Lord. These kind of things hold together. The Apostle Paul is so clear about these things. Now, people in churches are not always that clear. There's people, I'm sure there's people in churches today who still think, oh, I believe in God, I must be a good Christian. And they don't think any further than that. Believing in God, that's being a Christian. Or they say, I believe in Jesus. But when you ask them, well, kind of, and what do you believe about Jesus? They really can't say too much, you see. Ignorance of the Apostle Paul and his teaching often just translates into ignorance of the gospel. And you really got to wonder whether this person is saved at all. The Apostle Paul is so clear. There's God and his son Jesus working together. God sending Jesus. Jesus doing the will of his Father. And the center of that will was the cross. And atoning for sin. And the Apostle Paul is so clear about these things. And he's so clear if we're living the Christian life. Several times in this chapter here, he puts together faith and behaviour. The end of verse 5, a good conscience and a sincere faith. I believe in Jesus, yes, but are you doing what Jesus wants you to do? See, faith in Christ and serving Christ, having Jesus as Saviour and Jesus as Lord, these are not either ors, but they always go together. They always go together in the teaching of the Apostle Paul. And he also talks about those who are down in verse 19, holding faith and a good conscience. That's the Christian person, holding faith. Yes, we believe certain things and we're trusting in Jesus. We're holding faith and a good conscience. See, we're living it out in our daily lives. The Apostle Paul is so clear about the way of salvation and the place of Christ. Christ is the center of that. And then how to live the Christian life. The Apostle Paul is always so helpful. Yes, there are some things that are hard to understand. Even Peter, in his second letter, says that, which only means that sometimes we need to work harder when we're reading the Apostle Paul than maybe some other parts of the Scripture. But so here's Paul. Here's these opening words. I'm simply making the point. The Bible addresses us as individuals. And as a group, we've got group responsibilities. We also make a group response to what we find in the Bible. But if we want to be clear about the gospel, then the Apostle Paul is our best friend and our greatest help. He is so clear. He's on the money about these things. As soon as the Apostle Paul leaves the church, there's every danger that the gospel will leave with him. So if we're following Christ, let's listen to his chief minister, the Apostle Paul, as well. Let's pray. Yes, Father God, we thank you for how the Bible here challenges us. Yes, what do we think about Jesus? But also, what do we think about his most faithful servant, the Apostle Paul? Lord, please lay this on our heart. We really can't have Jesus without Paul. They go together. And so thank you that you've preserved the writings of the Apostle Paul. Thank you that you brought Reformation into the church in the 16th century and following because people rediscovered Paul. Lord, may the church continue to be reformed and its life and faith refreshed and clarified and purified as generation by generation we rediscover the Apostle Paul for ourselves. And we pray this in our Saviour's name. Amen. We'll sing our final hymn, and it's the hymn number 168, Ye Servants of God, Your Master Proclaim.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and forevermore.